And venerable nuns, dear devotees, first of all, I had to express my sincere gratitude for having invited me to come and deliver another talk in this year. I cannot guarantee for my voice. 2 days ago, I have completely lost my voice. I was about to telephone here to cancel this talk. Then I went to see a doctor. Well, he gave me a few antibiotics and a few tablets. Now voice is coming up slowly, but I cannot guarantee. Please forgive me. Well, the topics that we are going to discuss tonight. Why do we need a religion? We means humans. Because among the 31 groups of different kinds of living beings in this universe, only human beings have a religion. Others have no religion at all. That is why it is important. The Buddha has categorized the whole universe into 31 groups of living beings. Hell, a spirit, ghost, animals, humans are then divine beings, 6 kinds. Again, higher forms of divine being at Brahma, 16 kinds. Again, life without a physical body. And physical body without active mind. These are the 31 groups. So amongst those 31 groups, only human beings have a religion. What is the meaning of this word, religion? It is not an English word. It is a Latin word. Original word is religio, means binding. But when they introduced this as an English word, religion, they interpreted binding to God. Now worshipping, praying to God, there are so many other interpretations. But at the beginning, the original word is only for binding. The word religion and Buddhism. People always ask, is Buddhism a religion? If the meaning of that word, binding to God, then we cannot say Buddhism is not a religion. If they can interpret in this way, religion means a noble way of life for people to find out their final salvation, then we can accept Buddhism also as a religion. The word used by the Buddha is dharma, not religion. Of course, Buddha did not speak English. He used the word dharma. That word is very meaningful. Better than the word English, I mean the religion. He said, Paturahosi magadhesu pubbe dhammo asuddho samalehi chintito. After gaining his enlightenment, he said like this. This dharma that I understood is not a new dharma or not a new religion. This dharma existed long ago, but people have misinterpreted, polluted, forgotten. Therefore, the dharma is not existing in a human's mind. Dharma exists, but not existing in the human's mind. That is why the Buddhas will appear from time to time to reveal, to remind the humane qualities, human values, human intelligence, and how to practice a religion with human dignity, without becoming slaves either to God or to Buddha or religion. So he introduced a noble way of life as dharma or as religion for us to practice without suffering in the name of our religion, without torturing physical body because of our religion, and without enslaving to the sensual pleasure in this world, but by maintaining the dignity, by giving due credit to our intelligence, that is Buddhism. Now, the most important point is, why do we need, why only human beings maintain this religion? Because of human intelligence. This intelligence we cannot find in any other living beings. Hell, spirit, ghost, animals, and devas, brahmas, so-called divine beings also do not have this human intelligence. That is why only a human being can become a Buddha. A God cannot become a Buddha. That intelligence is not there. When human beings developed, cultivate, purified the mind, then gained the enlightenment, it is called Buddhahood. Only human beings can do that. Human mind is very advanced. It has taken, according to scientific discoveries, more than 4 million years to develop this human mind up to this extent and the formations of physical body in this manner. They say at least 4 million years. Therefore, the belief that people maintain human life is created by God at once is rejected by the intellectuals. Recently, Pope John is the living God on this earth for Catholics. He made an announcement. It appeared in the State Times. I got the paper cutting. He said, human beings were not created by God. Who says? Pope. They come into existence due to gradual development of evolution. When the theory of evolution, Charles Darwin introduced this evolution, they had a very big battle for nearly 100 years not to accept this evolution. Finally, they came to know intellectuals all over the world accepted that it is true. That is why Pope had to announce human beings were not created by God. They come into existence due to evolution. So, the intelligence that we maintain today is so advanced. One man's mind is strong enough to destroy the whole world today. There is no another living beings who can do that. Scientific discoveries, by using their independent intelligence, without depending on God or without depending on religion, by using only their intellect, certain things that they have discovered, we cannot imagine by using our normal mind. The nuclear weapons that they have discovered and produced, they say, all those nuclear weapons produced by these people, if dumped together and blast at once, within half an hour, the whole world turned into ashes. Whose work is done? Human mind. Not only that, moon also will be affected. This is the danger of the human mind if it is not diverted, guided, trained properly. Albert Einstein, very highly intellectual scientist, everybody respect him. He made two statements. Science without religion is blind. Religion without science is lame or crippled. Science without religion, they developed and developed, nobody to guide them. Finally, they produce atom bomb, now nuclear weapons, completely can ruin the whole world. Human intelligence that they misused and abused without no proper guidance from religion. On the other hand, religion without science, he says, lame, not active. That is why Pope decided to welcome scientific discoveries into religion. Otherwise, there will be no future for such religion in this world. Again, Albert Einstein says, according to our scientific education, in time to come, if religion is needed, only Buddhism can stand. He was not a Buddhist. He has no religions. But by using his intelligence, he said like this. Because religions depend or based on belief. But science, they discover through experiment. No belief there. So the belief that people maintain according to their respective religions will be affected very badly because of scientific discoveries. Now in the West, nearly 50% dropped their not Christians anymore, 50%. Every Western country. Many of them remain as free thinkers. Some of them approach Buddhism. In England, Buddhism is the second religion in that country. There are 400 Buddhist centers in England. There are 2,000 Buddhist centers in America. Fast growing religion. Why? The religion that appeals to intellectuals' mind who have developed their scientific knowledge. There is nothing for them to disagree with the teachings of the Buddha according to their discoveries. So far, they could not utter even one word against the teachings of the Buddha. Scientific. So, why religion is needed? Human beings can become the most cruel, the most wicked, the most cunning, the most selfish living being in this universe. Others cannot develop those mental attitudes up to such extent. On the other hand, only human beings can cultivate sympathy, kindness, compassion, honesty, patience, tolerance, harmony, unity, understanding. Religion is important to cultivate these good qualities in that human mind. Otherwise, religion does not mean, or the purpose of religion is not for us to worship and pray and to perform all these rites and rituals and ceremonies and burning all sort of things in the name of religion. There is no religion there. We cannot say those who pray so many times a day are religious people. We cannot say those who spend millions of dollars for rites and rituals in the name of religion that they are religious people. From the Buddhist point of view, when the Buddha was about to pass away, so many people assembled with flowers to offer and pay respect. The disciple, Venerable Ananda, advised them not to come and disturb the Buddha at this moment. The Buddha overheard, then asked Ananda, "Why? What is happening?" Then he told, "There are so many people who are waiting to come and offer flowers and pay respect to you, having heard that you are going to pass away." You know what the Buddha said? Ask them to go back. They cannot pay respect to the Buddha by offering flowers and by worshipping. Ask them to go back and practice at least one of the advices given by the Buddha. Then they really respect the Buddha. Now here you can understand who the Buddha is. He never asked anybody to come and pray and worship. Never. One of the disciples every day come in front of the Buddha and watching, just like watching televisions. So the Buddha asked, his name is Vakkali. "Vakkali, what are you doing here?" Then he said, "Venerable sir, when I look at your serenity, features, complexion, gives me a lot of happiness. Then what the Buddha says in his own language? Kinte vakkali imina putikayena duggandena sarirena. Vakkali, by watching this dirty, filthy, impermanent physical body, what do you gain? Nothing. You entertain your emotion. You never gain knowledge or understanding or purity just because you enjoy by entertaining your emotion. Then he said, Yo dhammang passati, so mang passati. One who sees the dharma taught by me, through this dharma, they can see the Buddha. Not through the physical body. Physical body is not the Buddha. There is no difference whatsoever. Your physical body and my physical body and the physical body of the Buddha, there is no difference. Enlightenment is not in the physical body. That is why he said, by watching this body, what do you gain? But if we can understand what the Buddha taught, then you can see the real Buddha in your mind. You create the real Buddha in your mind. Therefore, don't depend on this physical body. So he did not encourage even to respect, to worship his physical body. So, the main purpose is to cultivate, to develop, to purify the mind. Not worshipping and praying and performing all sort of rites and rituals. One day, when the Buddha was going somewhere, he met a Brahmin. Brahmin means Brahmana. Hindu priests and teachers, and they are the high caste people in India. He met the Buddha. He could not understand actually whether this is a human being because he has never seen such human figure. He approached the Buddha and asked, May I know whether you are a god? The Buddha says, No, I am not a god. Many others try to say they are god or son of god. The Buddha says, No, I am not a god. Then he asked, Any other form of supernatural living being? He said, No, I am very natural. Then he asked, In that case, are you an ordinary human being? The Buddha says, No. Now confusing in his mind who this man is. Then directly, then who are you? The Buddha gave the answer. This self-introduction is very important for us to understand who the Buddha is. Now, if anybody come and ask, You worship, you believe, you follow the Buddha. Can you tell me actually who this Buddha is? Can you explain? You may say something, but you do not know who the Buddha is. He introduced himself in this way. Abhinyayang abhinyatam. I understood everything that which exists in this world. How did he do that? Not within one lifetime. He went on developing, cultivating his mind, life after life, such a long period. Developed the mind up to the maximum level. That is why he say, I understood everything that exists in this world. Bhavetabhancha bhavitam. I have practiced all the great qualities, virtues, principles and morals and anything which is good. I have practiced. Pahatabhaṃ pahīnaṃ me. I have uprooted or eradicated all the evil thoughts, words and action. Completely eradicated. Now we can understand the difficulty in our case, very minor impurity in our mind, jealousy. We know very well we never gain anything by harboring jealousy, but we cannot drop it. We maintain this jealousy in our mind. And what about anger? What about greed? What about selfishness? He could manage to drop one by one, everything until he completely purified the mind. Tasma buddhosmi brahmana. Therefore, I am not a god, not a supernatural living being, not an ordinary man. I am the Buddha. This is the meaning of the word Buddha. I repeat, one who has understood this knowledge is not given by God. Through his own effort, life after life, he went on developing and developing. He understood. Then he practiced all the great qualities, virtues, principles, and morals, then eradicated all the evil thoughts, word, action. Then he gained enlightenment. This word enlightenment very loosely we use. The real meaning of enlightenment is this. One who understood everything, one who cultivated all the great qualities, virtues, one who has eradicated all the evil, wicked, harmful things, then gained the enlightenment. This is the real meaning of the Buddha. We follow his guidance, advice given by the Buddha. Not as religious law, not as commandment, not because of punishment, but by knowing why these things are bad, why these things are good, not because God revealed to us, these things are bad, don't do, otherwise I'll punish you. These things are good, you must do, otherwise I cannot take you to heaven. There is no such teaching in Buddhism. Recently, I was invited to give a Buddhist talk in a Catholic church. Occasionally, they invite us, and we invite them also. After my talk, somebody asked this question. You say, Buddha says like this. And we say, Jesus says like this. Who is correct? Then I told him, my dear friend, you can forget your Jesus. I can forget the Buddha. Use our common sense. Use our common sense. Then we can understand who is right, who is wrong, what is right, what is wrong. Example. The Buddha says we should not steal. Jesus says, thou shalt not steal. Do you think without Buddha, without Jesus, we cannot understand that stealing is bad? Why don't you depend on them to understand that it is bad? That is the Buddha's way of teaching. Through your own experience, through your understanding, you will come to know why it is bad. Example, he says, I advise you not to kill, not to destroy other living beings. If you can understand why it is bad, then when another person come and try to kill you, how do you feel? That experience is enough for you to understand why it is bad. Not necessary to say, Buddha says we should not kill. God says we should not kill. That is children's language. Understanding people, when maturity is there in our mind, sense of reasoning we had to develop. Many religions do not allow people to use their sense of reasoning. You have no argument. This is given by the God. Whether you like or not, whether you can understand or not, your duty is to accept it. Nothing to think, must accept. What the Buddha says, don't accept anything what I said, thinking Buddha is a great man. You never learn anything. You depend on Buddha, but you never learn anything. You have to think, you have to use your sense of reasoning, then you can understand. We have a thinking mind. Why we are called manushya? Do you know the meaning? We human beings are called manushya in so many languages. It's a Sanskrit word. Very meaningful word. Mana means mind. Manusya means one who can raise, develop, cultivate that mind. That living being is called manusya. But other living beings, they too have a mind for their survival. They can use their mind to find out their food, their shelter, to protect their life, and little bit of sensual pleasure. They cannot extend their mind further. Limited only for these people. It is mentioned very clearly in Sanskrit language. Ahara nidra bhaya maitunancha samanya metat pasubhirnarana. Eating, sleeping, self-protection, and what you call sexual pleasure. These four things are common to every living being in this world. Whether big or small makes no difference. Every creature, tiniest creature, also experience eating, sleeping or relaxing, or fighting to protect their life and sexual pleasure. If human beings also spend their life only for these four things, is there any difference between humans and animals? We think we are superior, we are more advanced, we are so intelligent. Have we got anything to prove that we are higher than animals? Yes, there is something. We have something which they haven't got. Dharmo hite sang adhiko visesa. Just now I mentioned, we have dharma. Now we say religion. This we can find only human's mind, not in others' mind. This is extraordinary characteristic that human beings have. But our greed, our selfishness, our cunningness completely spoiled our intelligence. They dominate our mind, then we forget we are humans. Humane qualities, human values, human intelligence surrender. When greed, selfishness, hatred appeared in the mind. Again, there is another point. Amongst those 31 group of living beings, only human beings tell lies. Yes. Others do not know how to tell lies. That is cunningness. How much this cunningness is developed in our mind to twist and turn. I can tell you a very simple story, but not very pleasant one. Please forgive me. A very young housewife, in the kitchen, there was a young boy also in that house. This young wife and this young boy were kissing in the kitchen. Husband saw this. Came in and asked, "What are you doing?" You know, at once, this lady says, "Do you know, every day I keep some durian here in this bottle. I can see 2-3 pieces are missing every day. When I ask this boy whether he take, he say no. Today I want to smell his mouth." Can you imagine? Only 1 second to create that story. This is the nature of the human mind. Is there anybody else who can do that in this world? See how clever we are. So, we can twist and turn our mind and can tell lies. It is mentioned, when the Buddha, as a Bodhisattva, before gaining enlightenment, he is called Bodhisattva. Anybody who is working for gaining enlightenment is called Bodhisattva. Occasionally, he has violated certain precept as a worldly person. But he upheld one particular precept, not to violate that. What is that? Telling lies. He tried his best not to break this. After gaining enlightenment, the words the Buddha has said came out from his holy sacred mouth. The words are still effective. Last 2,500 years, people have been experiencing what sort of effect they had either by reciting or listening the word come out from the Buddha's mouth. Same language. Disciples maintain the same language, the same word that the Buddha has spoken for 45 years. So these words are very effective because you are the only human beings on this earth who never uttered a lie. These are the special characteristics of the Buddha that people do not know. Some people say, When they say you are worshipping the Buddha, you say you are worshipping the devil. You see how narrow and how, what do you call, low mentality that they have to say like this. You are worshipping the devil. Now, when we recite the precept, five precepts, before we start religious service, it is the customary religious practice, first observe the five precepts, and then continue the religious service. Panatipata veramani sikkhapadam samadhyami, adinnadana veramani sikkhapadam, kamesumichachara veramani sikkhapadam, musavada veramani sikkhapadam, suramere majjhapamadatthana veramani sikkhapadam. Five. I try my best not to kill, not to steal, not to have sexual misconduct, not to tell lies, not to take intoxicating drinks or drugs. These are the five basic religious principles for every Buddhist to observe. Do you know, in every religion, there are few basic religious principles. Now, Islam, they have five pillars. Belief in God, praying, fasting, charity, pilgrimage to Holy Land. Five. These are the five pillars in Islam. Christianity, they have 10 commandments. So the Buddhists observe these five principles. Sikkha padang. Adi is the most important word there. I try to train my mind. Sikkha pad. I try to train my mind. When that bad thought appear in my mind, not to do this. This is the Buddhist. Not, or this is given by the God. This is given by the Buddha. This is given by so and so. No. I train my mind not to do that, knowing that it is bad, it is wicked, it is cruel, it is harmful, it is dangerous. I train my mind not to do that. That is the Buddhist principle. We cannot say, oh, I cannot do that because Buddha says I cannot do that. I cannot eat this because Buddha says we cannot do it. This is small children's language. Children say, Papa say, I cannot go there. If I go there, he will beat me. Mama, Mommy say, I cannot eat this, he will beat me. The same language. We are adult. We have maturity. We have sense of reasoning in our mind. Without misusing, abusing, without following anything blindly, use your common sense, my dear friend. Not necessary to have religious label. Whether we are Buddhists or Christians or Hindus or Muslims, those labels are not important. Religion is not in their labels. That is why the whole world today is a battlefield because of religion. Religious label, not religious principles. I want to introduce my religion, egoism, my religion, our religion, but not religion. Two religions introduce the same principles, but one religion tried to convert this onto the other religion. But the same principle, two labels. So they are fighting for this label. They bring religion into the battlefield to justify, oh, it is our religion. They have polluted completely purity of religion. They try to show worshipping, praying so many times a day, they are religious. But their cruelty, anger, jealousy, grudge and ill will, enmity, all the evil forces are boiling in their mind. Where is religion? What is the purpose of religion? Religion is for us to train our mind to live peacefully, without harming, without disturbing, developing our, what you call, harmony, understanding, and without violating the environment for others to suffer. If these qualities are not in our religion, there's no point of following any religion. Now, there are free thinkers. They never say they are Buddhists or Christians or Muslims or Hindus. No label. But do you think they behave as barbarians? If you observe very carefully, some of them are far better than those so-called religious people who claim they are belong to this religion or that religion. By knowing certain things are bad, immoral, harmful, they try not to do. That is understanding. Not because of God, not because of punishment, not because of hell. Knowing these things are wrong. Again, they do lot of services for the well-being of others, to release others' sufferings and troubles and problems and difficulties without expecting any reward from God. They have no heaven, no God, no hell, no rebirth, no karma, no soul, nothing. But they live as human beings. So they keep away from bad things. They do lot of good things without using any religious label. Why? Although they do not use any religious labels, they practice religious principles. Without them, we are belong to this religion. Religious principles are there. Therefore, not necessary to say we are Buddhist. That word is not important. The Buddha was not a Buddhist. Jesus was not a Christian. We have given this label for them. We must try to be good, to do good as much as possible. Then we are very good religious people. You can give any label. It is immaterial. On the other hand, among the followers of other religions, Christians, Muslims, and Hindus, we have seen, we have been associating with them, some of them are better than Buddhists. Their kindness, compassion, honesty, all the good qualities, they have developed already in their mind. Therefore, we cannot say we Buddhists are the good people, religious people in this world. That is egoism. Try to avoid this. Then we can keep away from hostility, discrimination, to live peacefully with others. Recently, I was invited to give a talk at International Islamic University on Buddhism. After my talk, somebody got up and asked, why Buddhists do not believe in God? I asked, who told you? Who told you that Buddhists do not believe in God? You are wrong. Buddhist concept on God is different. Not like Christians or Muslims or Hindus But Buddhist concept is different. Otherwise, no one can say Buddhists do not believe in God. Anyway, my topic will be, next topic will be that. For you to understand. You must never say, as Buddhists, we don't believe in God. You create unnecessary misunderstanding, hostility, discrimination. Why do you want to create this? I went to attend an international Islamic conference, invited us to visit there. As soon as I enter into that building, a Muslim group who have come from another country, I think they had never seen a Buddhist monk in their life, yeah, straight away, he said, do you believe in God? I said, why not? No argument. Finish. Because that is not the way to ask a question. Where are you coming from? What is your religion? We are very happy to see you here. By the way, may I know what is your concept on God? That is the what you call cultured way. What state way here? Do you believe in God? See the mentality. When people talk religion so seriously into their mind, they develop some sort of egoism, pride, and they are superior to others. We should not maintain in that way. So again, let us come back. Why religion is needed? Human mind can understand. This is not the first and the last life. Others have no such idea. They do not know anything about the next life hereafter. Only human being. If we can understand this, it is our duty to prepare for the next existence. That is why we need a religion. Otherwise, we do not know. Now, there are millions of human beings in many parts of the world who are dying, starving without food. Millions of human beings have no shelter. Their birth and death both take place at the pavement or roadside or under the tree or open areas during the summer and winter rain season. Also, they have to spend their life like this. Then who are these human beings? If people believe all these human beings are created by the God, then why did God create those millions of innocent people to suffer for nothing? Is there any reason? If he has created, it is not his duty to provide food and clothing and shelter and their requisite. When a father produces few children, he keeps quiet without doing anything. Children every day must come and kneel down, Father, we want food. Father, we want clothing. Father, we want our books. Is that the way? Is that the duty of the father? Then who created them to suffer like this for nothing? Nobody created them. This is a living example for us. Compare our way of life and their way of life. How fortunate we are and how unfortunate they are. All are human beings. What is the cause? No doubt, they had little bit of good karma to be born as humans. But they have not accumulated enough good karma for them to experience in their next existence. That is the good lesson for all of us. Now we are experiencing good effect of our good karma. Yes, definitely. When you compare with others who suffer, again we are paying for what we have done, certain bad thing. In simple language, says like this. We are the result of what we were. We will be the result of what we are. Children also can understand this. Remember this. We are the result of what we were. If you are fortunate, that means we have definitely had some good deeds, meritorious deeds during our last birth. That is why we are experiencing leading a peaceful, happy life. If our lives are miserable, they are the result of what we were. We have done certain bad, wicked, cruel things during the previous birth. We are paying for that.